सदाशिवसमारम्भाम् शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। I welcome you all with my love and respects. Today's sutra, tatra sthitau yatna abhyasaha. The effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness is abhyasa. Patanjali is giving us one more chance. He is explaining abhyasa in a very deep way. Today I am going to say it. Abhyasa, this one word, is the key word for the whole civilization. Please understand that from animals evolving as human beings, and in the human being level, expressing various things, whether it is spiritual knowledge or things of the outer world, whatever, expressing all those things. The whole thing happens with one idea, abhyasa. I can say abhyasa is the key for the whole thing. Whether it is success in the outer world or success in the inner world, research and development in the outer world or research and development in the inner world, anything achieved needs abhyasaha. That is why Patanjali talks about this abhyasa in a very deep way in this sloka. Patanjali uses very minimum words only for very important concepts. I can say this, each sutra, he reduces one full tree to the seed form, and that seed he offers. Each sutra is a seed out of which a whole tree can be created. And I can say he has reduced the whole tree into a seed, an offering. So he never uses extra words or extra concepts or extra words for the same concepts. It doesn't do all the three, neither extra words nor extra concepts or extra words for same concept. It doesn't do any of this. Minimum concepts and minimum words to express. Here, for abhyasa, is giving one more chance, because we don't catch the truth. See, there are some truths he wants us, we should never miss it. Even if we skip one or two words, we should not miss it. That's the reason he is putting all effort, more effort, and describing abhyasa. In last sutra he described about abhyasa and vairagya. Now he is giving a deep description, very detailed description, definition of abhyasa. तत्र स्थितौ यत्नः अभ्यासा. The effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness is abhyasa. Abhyasa means, if I have to loosely translate, I can say practice. That word is too small, but no other word. Abhyasa means again and again bringing yourself back to that center, elevating yourself to that higher state of consciousness. Centralizing yourself in the truth. He is giving us one more chance and describing it more detailed way, because he wants us to remember this idea. He says, understand, I have given so much of importance to this idea, so understand the importance of this idea in your day-to-day life. He is giving us one more chance. I have one story about chance. I'll read it out because it's there. The words are very nice. A convention to prove that accountants are not stupid is set up in a massive stadium. Accountants from all over the world watch as the MC calls up the first volunteer, one senior accountant, and asks him, what is 15 plus 15? After 20 seconds, that volunteer says 18. Everyone is a little disappointed, but all the accountants started yelling. They start yelling, give him another chance, give him another chance. The MC says, well, I guess we can give him another chance. He asks, what is 5 plus 5? After 30 seconds, the volunteer says 90. Everyone is crestfallen, but the accountants again start yelling, give him another chance, give him another chance. The MC says, okay, one last chance. What is 2 plus 2? The accountant closes his eyes after a whole minute. Eventually says 4. MC looks very relieved, but suddenly all the accountants start yelling, give him another chance, give him another chance. So Patanjali is giving us one more chance. Abhyasa. Just 1 month before, one of our devotees in India sometime used to come and go to the ashram. I'll describe my experience with him. Then I'll describe exactly what is abhyasa. Usually I don't see or look into the minds of the people. Only when they ask me to guide them, only when they request me sincerely, Swamiji, please look inside and guide, I try to look inside their mind. Otherwise I never look inside, because I respect their privacy. And who wants to look all the junk? One, I respect the privacy. The other one, who wants to look inside all the junk? So, that day, he requested me for some guidance. I told him, all right, give me a little time. I'll just see whatever is going on inside your mind, then guide you. He was in a big trouble. The trouble is, he was in love with somebody. That person is not looking at him. That person is not giving attention, not giving care, not bothered about him. So it was torturing him. Around 8:30 early morning, he came out of his room, and he was around me. I could see very clearly what was going on inside his inner space. He did not describe, but I can relate. He was coming to the temple with me, he was walking with me. After a few minutes, he received a call from his house. He has some difficulty, he has some problem in his house, means the house is going to be taken away by the bank, some serious issue. Suddenly I saw his mind started fighting with that problem. Till then he was fighting with this problem that I am giving so much attention, sending so many signals, the other person is not responding, the other person is not understanding. I really care for her, or I really love her. That was the complication going on, means the kind of a conflict inside. Suddenly this conflict took over. I could see very clearly how that whole game of mind is happening. This complication took over. This is a very serious survival issue. House is a survival issue. So this complication started happening. I saw this, he completely forgot about her or his love, everything is forgotten. He is fully busy with this one idea, one concept, that is, he is in trouble and his house is in trouble. The basic things need to be attended. All the complications goes on, he was in tension. And he asked me, Swamiji, how to solve this issue, how to attend this issue. I very casually said that don't worry, the things will be settled. Some consolation I gave. And maybe after 1 hour, he received a call that problem got settled. The problem got settled. Suddenly when he came out of the problem, he felt so relieved. The morning suffocation which he had, the difficulty which he had, constantly he was thinking about, oh, I am giving so much attention to her, she is not caring. That nagging feeling, that feeling completely disappeared in him. I saw he is completely relieved, not only from this problem, from that problem also. When he came out of this problem, not only from this problem, he got solved. He came out of that problem also. I was surprised. How come? One problem, if he comes out of this problem, only this problem should get solved. How come that problem is also solved? He is completely clear. Then I saw his mind. I could see his inner space. There was no difficulties. He was in completely peace and rest. Please understand, I am describing exactly as it happened inside the inner space. If you look inside, you can also see what I am saying will be true many times in your life. He got completely relieved from the whole problem. I asked him, how do you feel now? He understood. I am seeing the whole thing happening inside him. Suddenly he said, I also don't understand, Swamiji. Morning I felt so much nagging by that one idea, she is not responding to me, she is not understanding my love. I was suffering. But when I had some survival problem, bigger problem, that got disappeared. It was pushed backside. Now when this problem got solved, I thought that problem will come up. Now I'll pick up that problem. But it's not happening. Once this problem is solved, I am completely at ease, at peace. I don't know how. Please understand, the whole thing, every moment, your idea about pain, your idea about pleasure, your idea about joy, your idea about love gets changed. If a new wave comes, you don't know what that new wave will make, what changes it will make inside you. If some other wave comes, you don't know what changes that wave will make inside you. Your mind is not a logical thing. If it was logical, what should have happened after the second problem got solved? You should have started thinking about first problem. But it is not happening. You can see even in your life, sometime when some serious problems comes up and it gets solved, it gets moved, you will see suddenly you are completely relaxed, you are in the restful awareness, you are not bothered about some other problems which you are thinking, which you are contemplating, on which you are working. The big difficulty is you always think mind is logical. Mind is logical. Please understand, mind is not like a solid ground, it is an ocean. One wave, when it comes, it can clear some 10 problems which was there. Problem can dissolve problems. Wave can move waves. Many times, please understand, I can say this is one of the important truth I want to drill inside your inner space today. This is one important thing, truth, I want to drill inside. Problems can wash away problems. What do I mean by this word, problems can wash away the problems? All your ideas about problems do not have base. It's like a floating. It is floating. Your idea about love, your idea about pain, your idea about attention, your idea about fear, your idea about worry, your idea about greed, your ideas, all these ideas are all just floating. They are not clearly rooted or hooked or grounded. They are all just floating. One wave is enough. Suddenly you will see so many things which you are thinking can never be removed, just disappears. I asked him, did you imagine the problem which you are thinking morning, early morning contemplating, will leave your inner space? Never imagined so much. I never imagined that will leave my inner space so easily, because that was haunting my inner space for quite a long time. That was there in my inner space continuously. So I never thought it will disappear or it will just move out of my inner space. Understand, sometimes problems can remove problems from your inner space. The big problem when it comes to survival, see when his house was in problem, the big wave started happening inside his inner space. Suddenly all the small waves, all the small problems disappeared. If you look inside, actually if you observe how your mind works, if you understand what I said now, this one big problem raising and suddenly all the small problems disappearing. When the big problem is also solved, you are completely in peace. Even the small problems are not there anymore, even though you have not solved it. See, this guy is only first big problem got sorted out. The small problems did not get sorted out. That small, he did not solve the small problems. The small problems did not disappear. It's not that she started responding to him, or he feels that she is now ready, or she is responding, nothing. The second problem is there. That small problem is there. But suddenly it has no power over him. His inner space is not disturbed at all by it. I told him, understand, this is what is the base. This is what is the basic understanding which you need to know. This understanding will completely liberate you. Your respect for mind will be lost. First thing you need to know, your respect for your problem should disappear. Somebody asked me, Swamiji, do you mean to say my problems are not big? I told him, sorry to tell the truth. First of all, you are not big. Forget about your problems. But it hurts. It really hurts. Somebody saying you are not big is too much. What to do? The big problem is when your problems are big, you feel you are big. You feel you are big. Many times I have seen in those days, whenever people come, I used to tell them, hey, stay some time here and live around. Then I started seeing these guys, only then they create all kinds of problem in the mind. No, I have to go to job, I have this, I cannot sit here, I cannot meditate, I am too lazy. They have all kinds of problem. If I tell them, no, you can't stay, there is no time, there is no place here, go back. Then they have all kinds of problem. No, I want to be around you. You are not letting us stay. You are not giving us enough attention. You are not loving me. They have all problem. I started creating reverse problems. No, really. See, if I tell them stay, just stay here. Stay around me. It's an amazing chance. Then they say, no, I have a job. I have this. I am too lazy. I can't do this. I think I am a load. They have all kinds of reasons. Then I started doing the other way. I tell, if they wanted to stay, I tell them, no, you can't stay. Just go. Then they have this problem. No, we want to stay here. You are not letting us stay. You are not entertaining us. You are too busy with too many things. See, mind, either this way or this way, it constantly creates waves. It constantly creates waves. That is why mind is wavering. It is an action. Mind is a verb. Please understand, it is a verb. It is an action. Patanjali says very beautifully, it is not a thing, it is an action. Just remember, it is an action and stop it. Nothing else. I told him, now do you understand the value of the mind? He says, sure, Swamiji. I can never imagine that I can forget the problem which I was having with the person whom I am in love with. He thought, this problem was haunting me for days. I thought this will continue to haunt me for days. But suddenly how this has disappeared. One more important secret you should know. Whenever you go through the basic fears, huge energy from Swadhisthana gets released to take you out of that fear. There is automatic mechanism inside you. There is automatic mechanism. If you go through any pain, after a certain limit, you will fall unconscious because there is automatic anesthetic method. It just puts you in unconscious layer. You will fall into the unconscious, you won't feel the pain. Same way, even fear. After a certain limit, if the fear is too much, there will be huge energy rush inside you. That energy rush is intelligent enough to push all other pains, all other sufferings, all other thoughts, all other problems. Understand the key. First key you need to understand. First truth you need to understand. Your problems are not as you think. They are neither permanent nor impermanent as you think. If you think they are impermanent, they are not impermanent as you think. If you think they are permanent, they are not permanent as you think. Your ideas about your problems are not right. This is the first understanding I want you to know. The first understanding. Because many times, any other simple problem, you will forget about this whole thing. You will forget about this whole thing. Sometimes, even very simple problem can occupy your whole inner space. You will forget about an important problems. You are just too busy with the cock and bull stories. And the important things are unattended. It is there lying, unattended. You are just caught with these small, small things. You are too busy with these small things, settling small things without bothering about the big things happening in your life. Abhyasa, please understand. Abhyasa means the first thing. Understanding your problems are neither permanent nor impermanent. Your understanding about the problems are not right. The next step for Abhyasa, second step for Abhyasa is coming back to your center again and again and again. For enlightenment, you need only three things. One, Abhyasa. Second, Abhyasa. Third, Abhyasa. Forget about enlightenment. Even for living an integrated life, even for living integrated life, all you need is Abhyasa. I can say, the Abhyasa can be understood from two angles, two ways. One, by constantly coming back to the center, letting everything else melt. Second, by constantly melting, not letting samskaras gather around you. See, relaxing from wrong abhyasas, resting in the right truth. Relaxing from the wrong abhyasas means your conditioning. Your conditioning, actually, you can understand Abhyasa in two ways. One thing, not letting any Abhyasa means practice happening inside you. Not allowing any practice. See, all your sufferings are because of your practices. All your sufferings are because of your practices. That's the reason you can see in your life. Everything is because of your practices. Man is not just a conscious being. His conscious level, layer, is only one layer. His unconscious layer is 9 times bigger than conscious layer. And his body is completely unconscious. Body is created out of non-voluntary habits, which has become part of your unconscious. Whatever your conscious does, again and again and again and again and again, repeating, 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 that becomes body. Anything repeated by your conscious becomes unconscious and becomes your body. You can see in your life. For example, driving. In the beginning, you need to put so much of effort. You have to do this, that, right turn, left turn. For each decision, the brain has to give the command, it has to pass through the hand, and it should be executed. But after some time, you will sit in your car, reach your office, only when you park the car and come out of the car, you will remember, oh God, last 1 hour I was driving. Sometimes you even run over people. Anyhow, so many decisions you took, right turn, left turn, stopping at the signal, so many decisions, you are not even aware because it has become non-voluntary action, part of your unconscious. If you understand Abhyasa in this way, if you don't allow any Abhyasa, you are liberated, you are enlightened. Means every moment you will be fresh, alive. Your muscles will be so strong, alive. One more thing, your abhyasa is directly connected to your muscles. Anything you do again and again and again, if it is negative, it weakens your muscles. Anything you do again and again and again with consciousness, it strengthens your muscles. That is why our rishis are saying, the more you age, more strong you should become. Of course, it feels paradoxical. They say, more you are aging means more experience in the planet Earth, more experience with your body, more experience with your mind. So naturally you should become more strong and intelligent. But something goes wrong in the whole cycle. Something wrong happens. We start encouraging negative abhyasas, negative ideas, getting stronger and stronger and stronger. See, when I say negative ideas, the unconscious things, they become stronger and stronger and stronger. Unconscious things do not become that strong inside our inner space. Somehow, basically, your being by its nature wants to be in a restful awareness mood. Being conscious and restful awareness needs a training which is not provided to you by the civilization or the society or the school or colleges. But being unconscious and relaxing into the restful awareness is taught to you by your colleges and universities and schools. Please understand, this is an important key. By your nature, you want to be in restful awareness. People come and tell me, I am too lazy to meditate, Swamiji. I tell them, just be too lazy to think, that's all. That is meditation. No, I am too lazy to go through programs. I tell them, you don't have to do programs, just be too lazy to think, that's all. You are in meditation. The problem is, two ways of restful awareness. One, being in the restful awareness consciously. Second, being in the restful awareness unconsciously. The second process is taught to you by your schools, colleges, universities. Nothing. In India, I have seen. By the time this guy finishes his school and comes out, he has mastered the art of sitting and sleeping with open eyes. Teacher goes on talking. Somehow I was never able to do that. That's why I never sat in classes. I can't do. See, for example, poor guys, they are made to sit and windows are locked, room is locked. And the teacher, at least that guy should be very entertaining. And that poor guy, what he will do, he is talking about the same subject 25 years. The same subject, same maths or same science, he is talking for last 25 years. What he will do? He will turn towards the board and talk to board, blackboard, and these kids will be talking among themselves. He shouts back, hey, keep quiet, sit straight. Then they will sit. But somehow, the consciousness never gets involved with the life. Please understand. If there is no interest created, enthusiasm created about the things you are attending, if it is compulsion, naturally, by and by, you will master the art of disconnecting even your eyes and senses are open. I have seen one guy, I told one of my brahmachari to go to a new center and work. somehow he is not happy with the head of that center. He said, I don't want to go. He did not have the courage to tell me. So he told another one, Brahmachari, I don't want to go. I think I am feeling little feverish. 2-3 times he was telling this. Next day morning I went to his room and asked, what happened? You did not go to the center, that center. He said, no, I am feeling feverish. I touched him once, really he was having fever. I told him, all right, you don't need to go to that center. You just relax here itself. In 2 hours, he's all right. No, really. When you need to sit and attend, if you are not interested, see, why you don't feel interested? Because you don't know the direct result. See, when you are in the schools and colleges, they don't take so much of passions to convince you about what you need to know. Because first of all, they are not convinced. They themselves don't know, by learning this, is it going to help you? See, it is generalized. First problem is generalization. Second problem, they themselves don't know what they are teaching is, whether it is going to be helpful for you in the life or not. Not really. One of my teachers told me directly, we are 25 years behind the, I was doing diploma in mechanical engineering. He told me, we are 25 years behind the industry. If you go for a job in any industry today, maybe in their old shed or in their old godown or archives, you can see the machines which you are seeing in the schools and colleges now. The machines with which you are working, you may not see, you may see only in museum. You may only see in archives. So first of all, the teachers are not convinced about what they are teaching. And naturally, that expresses in their method of teaching. And the students are also not convinced about the utility value. There is so much of gap between the person who is designing the system and the person who is put inside the system. So much of gap. So the transmission of intensity and enthusiasm is disturbed. It's like in Zen they have an example. They say, if you wash a cup in which the tea was there and pour that water in another one cup, and wash that cup and pour that water in another one cup, the last cup, will it know any taste or smell about the tea? No. Same way, many times in the many traditional mutts I have seen, they boast, my master is a great enlightened master. What is the use? That is like I am the teacup in which the water washed the teacup, then water washed that teacup, then water wash that teacup is kept. No taste, no smell. This cup will no way know the taste or the smell of the original tea. Means the enthusiasm, the intelligence, the understanding never gets transmitted if the gap is too much. Same way, the designing, the education system, the designers, and the person who is going through the system, the gap becomes too much. And for so many other reasons, because of so many other reasons, you are never taught how to be in the restful awareness consciously. You are always taught restful awareness means unconscious. Switch off, only then you can be in restful awareness. Then what happens? All your unconscious samskaras get strengthened. The abhyasa happens in you also, but unconscious level. Things which are not needed becomes abhyasa in you. Things which are not going to be directly helpful for your consciousness becomes abhyasa in you. See, in your life, anything which makes you unconscious, You make that habit very quickly. Very quickly it becomes your habit. Drinking, smoking, drugs, anything which makes you unconscious. TV. When you are watching TV, you don't have to think about you. You can constantly go on laughing at others, making fun of others. See, you need so much of entertainment. Why? Because you can't be with yourself. You can't be with yourself. India, the other day, near our ashram, they inaugurated a theme park. They requested me to come and inaugurate the theme park. I said no. They asked me, what is this, Swamiji? Nothing wrong in theme park. I said, I am feeling so bad. This country needs theme parks to entertain people. Means what? The depression level is going high. Depression level is going high. Now we need to invent more and more and more different entertainments. The great civilization, the Vedic civilizations, even their entertainment was conscious based. Prayer, meditation, different techniques, going to different places of worship, different energy centers, different energy fields. Even entertainment was conscious based in our civilization, in the Vedic civilization. But now I am seeing, even entertainments need to be adrenaline based. Adrenaline based means moving your body fast, giving you kind of a surprise, shocks. All that roller coaster, everything is the entertainments which puts you unconscious. See, when the adrenaline release happens, you feel like a hero. It is literally like a dog eating its own leg. Please understand. It feels the blood, it enjoys the blood, but it doesn't know the after effect. It doesn't know it is eating itself. It is killing itself. You do not know the adrenaline release. It really entertains you for 5 minutes. You feel high, but you are entering into the unconscious enjoyments, unconscious entertainments, unconscious abhyasas. That is why so much of appeal about these horror movies. You know, after seeing that movie for 2 days, you can't relax. In the room, bedroom, even if small cat movement or dog movement or even screen movement. But somehow, even then, you again sit in front of the same movie. It's a kind of an unconscious abhyasa. Entertainment means putting yourself into the unconscious layer again and again and again. So the whole civilization, because it is very easy, see, unconsciously falling in tune is very easy. Consciously falling into the restful awareness means you need to practice little, you need to meditate, you need to practice. And you are never taught from the young age that is easy. You are always taught this is the easy. You are never taught meditation is easy. That's a big problem. Sometime when I look back, I feel so blessed. I was born and brought up in a place where meditation is a lifestyle, where from the young age, I know it is easy. During my teenage, I just used to sit for 6-7 hours, especially in my college. Morning around 3 o'clock, I'll get up. I'll just sit till 9 o'clock. 5-6 hours. My roommates, these guys are not ready to believe I'm meditating. But anyhow, they got frightened seeing day in and day out, every day me sitting without moving the body continuously for so many hours. That itself is too much for them. They asked me once, what happened? How come you sit so many hours just like that? Actually, they were not able to relate with what I am doing, how I am able to do. Same way, I was not able to relate with them. When they asked me, how are you able to do this? I told him, what is there? My body, my mind, I want to sit, I am sitting, that's all. I can understand. None of you are able to relate with what I am saying. Maybe in the mind you are saying, give him one more chance. Negative abhyasa, understand? Your body, your mind, if you can't sit with it, what is going on? What is happening? Reclaim. It is time. Reclaim your freedom. Reclaim your body. Reclaim your mind. Your inner space is yours. As I was telling yesterday, pratyahara is the ultimate freedom. Please understand. All other freedom is just idea. It is the idea taught to you. One lion had a huge flock of sheep. And every day it will kill one sheep and eat. Another lion asked, how come you manage all these guys in one place? Don't they run away seeing you? This lion said, no, no, no. I hypnotized them and told them all that they are all lions. And they don't run away when they see me. They are all there. I just go and pick up one and eat. Next day when I go there, they are all there. I pick up one and eat. Just like that lion has hypnotized all the goats and told that you are all lions. And those lions are all believing, that goats are all believing. And saying, yes, yes, we are lions, and sitting. Understand, all the freedom you have, whatever you think you have, all ideas about freedom, economical freedom, whatever you freedom you think you have, is only idea given to you. It is only idea given to you. The one and only freedom is pratyahara, means ability to be in your center. Except that, there is no other freedom. There is nothing else which can be called as freedom. You can see in your life, people think, oh, if I work for these 5 days, I have freedom to go for vacation in the 2 days. But try to go for vacation. You will be carrying all your files inside. You will be lying down in the Hawaii beach and thinking about the work only. What else? Only if you know how to get back to your center, you have freedom. As long as you live in the negative abhyasa cycle, means wrong things becomes your practice, unconscious things becomes your practice, unconscious things are drawing you more, unconscious things are centering yourself more, please understand. It is not that society has anger towards you and it teaches, it takes you, it takes revenge on you, it punishes you. No. They themselves are unconscious. Your parents are not hating you. They don't have hatred towards you. They themselves are unconscious. That is where the problem starts. They themselves don't know. The conscious abhyasa can be taught. I can clearly describe how that negative abhyasa get settled inside your system. First thing, the unconscious thing, you can see, when you start meditating, how difficult you feel. You will feel the same difficulty when you start drinking or when you start smoking also. Your system will go through the same resistance. When you start meditating, what resistance it goes through? The same resistance it will go through when you start using drug or smoking or drinking. Only thing, with this smoking or drinking or drug, you have company. Many people telling you, no, 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 it will become all right in 2 days. See, I am an example. You have so many living enlightened masters. You are surrounded by, so, sorry, not enlightened, unenlightened. There are so many people encouraging, enthusiastic. Company, the civilization. Actually, otherwise, can you imagine? I cannot imagine sending smoke inside my system. Oh God. How could these guys do? I don't understand. Simply, I can't relate with it. How can you put something inside your system which will make you dull? which will make you dumb, which will paralyze you, which will just make you forget things, which will not even let you remember what you are and who you are. I can't understand. Your system will naturally resist. But what happens? You have many people who are already in tune with that bio-memory, who have lived, who are living, their presence influences you. So the initial struggles, initial difficulties, actually, when I started practicing yoga, when I started practicing meditation, the initial resistance which I had, the same resistance you will also have when you start negative abhyasa. Fortunately, I had some guys who have done this positive work and became enlightened around me, continuously encouraging, giving enthusiasm, hey, come on, come on, come on, it's nothing, it's nothing, it's nothing. So I fell in tune with that. Unfortunately, people, when they have this wrong people around, then they feel connected, fell in tune, and start living this. The negative abhyasa, I can say, that is the ultimate conspiracy done to you. Whether it is anger, or greed, or fear, or drug, whatever. Negative abhyasa, please understand, negative abhyasa is the ultimate conspiracy, ultimate crime done against you, done against your consciousness, against your being. I can see very clearly. Sometimes I sit and wonder, when I see especially my brahmacharis and trying to train them, when I take the classes, I go around and take the classes, people find difficulty even to close eyes, forget about meditation. Just to close eyes, they feel frightened. No, no, no. Half an hour I have to close the eyes and sit. What? I cannot sit for half an hour with closed eyes. Who knows what will go on outside? One person told me, wrote me a letter in just few days before in a meditation camp. First time in my life, 2 days I was without watching CNN Swamiji. I said, oh God. See the negative abhyasas. Negative abhyasas. In every step, whatever you do becomes abhyasa. One more thing. If you understand the secret, if you understand the secret and not let that abhyasa happen to you, it will just start melting down. It will just start melting down. When it comes to negative things, do not allow abhyasa to happen. Be aware. More and more be aware. Whenever the suffering comes, do not allow the suffering to stay inside you. Just decide to entertain yourself in something else, not with the TV or not with other sufferings. I am not saying you to change sufferings, no. I am saying you to change the very energy, very thing, change. That is why in India we had so many wonderful positive entertainment things. In my native village I know, a man can be entertained throughout the year just based on the temple. Every day something or other will be going on in the temple. Every day you can be positively entertained, constantly remembering some positive ideas. One guy asked me, Swamiji, in your temple I saw every day some festival goes on. In India, in our temple, we call the temple Nityotsava, means eternal festival. Every day you will see the temple flag will be flying. Some Utsava will be going on. Something will be happening. Means constantly reminding them positive ideas and engraving positive abhyasa. Positive abhyasa. I asked him, when bars can be open every day, Why not temples? Why should temples be weakened? No. When bars can be opened every day, where the negative abhyasa is done, see, number of bars and number of temples should be at least equal. Because the negative abhyasa, all the units, places where negative abhyasa is happening are open 24 hours and available to the market, and whole civilization is encouraged. And why not the place where positive abhyasa is happening? Sometimes people ask me, Swamiji, what is this? In our ashrams and temples, people are dancing like a bar, like a pub. I tell them, if you drink and dance, it is negative abhyasa. If you just sing and dance, it is positive abhyasa. I have to equate. The big problem is, if you drink and dance, it is a culture. And if you sing and dance, you are old, outdated. See the mind. If you drink and dance, you are updated. You are updated. Fashion, modern. If you just sing the divine name, or the guru's name, or the god's name, and jump in that ecstasy and joy, immature fellows. I have seen in India, these old guys, they can't tolerate the Swami's dancing and spiritual religious crowd so happy. They always complain. In India, especially these Orthodox traditional people, they can't imagine a Swami can jump so freely and dance so freely and joyfully. They can't tolerate. They ask me. I tell them, are you able to stop the negative abhyasa? No. Then at least create some place where positive abhyasa is happening, so that people will start feeling connected. Actually, all the juicy, joyful things being removed from the positive energy field, when the celebration is removed from the spiritual tradition, be very clear, the positive abhyasa will never happen. Will never happen. Many people start drinking just because they can see many companions, many friends, they can start dancing, make more friends, and expand their identity. Many incentives, many other things are associated with drinking. I tell them, bring all those things, benefits, into spirituality, into meditation, into the bliss, into the joy. Create positive abhyasa. Create positive abhyasa. I have seen in India, when people drink and dance, nobody questions. Even those so-called orthodox elder people, they say, it's a culture. When people are singing and dancing with awareness, with consciousness, I tell you, without drinking, if you just sing and dance, if you are aware, and singing and dancing alive, remembering some great concepts like a master, God, or truth, with these great ideas, understand, those great truths will get engraved inside your system. Yesterday I told you an important secret. Any idea you strongly remember and move your body, that idea will get engraved into your biomemory. If you think, by bending up and down 10 times, your stomach will become healthy. You don't have to do anything. Nothing else is needed. Just that idea, I should become healthy and do up and down, you will become healthy. You don't have to learn a formal yoga, formal this session, that kundalini, that's yoga, that yoga, nothing. That is the whole science. I am revealing the whole science, whole secret to you. Understand? Otherwise, so many hundreds of varieties of yoga, body postures, exercises are there. Everything is helping. How can it be? If you go to one system, they say, for stomach problems, bend this way. If you go to other system, no. For stomach problem, you should never bend that way, bend this way. If you go to some other system, no, for stomach problem, you should neither bend nor stand, just lie down. The big problem is all three system works. How can that be? So with any strong idea inside, any way you move the body, that idea becomes part of your bio memory and brings result. That's all. This is the secret. This is the secret. The big, the positive abhyasa starts happening. Meera says, when I am singing his name and moving my body, I can see he himself is moving inside my body. His very presence moving inside my body. Positive abhyasa. The positive abhyasa is happening. The engraving of the positive ideas is happening. Understand? Two way. One, not letting negative abhyasa, negative memories gathering, negative practices happening. Second, letting positive memories happening continuously. Positive abhyasa happening continuously. Basically, you are liquid. You are liquid. In which vessel you are kept, you take the shape of that vessel. That's all. In which vessel you are kept, you take the form of that vessel. That is why I insist, create a positive, blissful community around you. Only then you can continue to be blissful and positive forever. Never just by you being positive. No. In India, there's a story. Even if you go up, there will be people just to pull you down. They will be just waiting to pull you down. Just go with a smiling, joyful face ecstatically to your house and see how many minutes. Fortunately, if your spouse is also here, then you are saved. No, otherwise, just understand. You are in ecstasy, independent of him. That is the big problem. See, if you are in ecstasy without depending on him or her, it is too much. And now naturally it will express in your body language, you will say you don't need him or her. That is another one big problem. And it hurts his ego. Be like me. At the most, you can be happy with my support. Other than that, nothing else should happen. And I have seen, people can't tolerate the other person's happiness, especially independent of me. That is too much. Understand? Unless you create a community where the whole thing is positive, positive abhyasa is happening, put little energy, put little time to create a beautiful community around you, or spend more time in a community where the positive abhyasa is happening, you will see so many wonderful things expressing inside you, expressing inside you. All your good or bad habits are because of abhyasa. Please understand how much one person has to struggle for meditation or yoga. That much equally he has to struggle to learn the habit of drinking or smoking or drug. I can say little more. He has to struggle. But unconsciously, society supports his unconscious abhyasa. With this, you don't have a support, the community supporting you, society supporting you. One day if you meditate and you have little knee pain, you tell your spouse, who asked you to do all these things? You will sit for half an hour and come and tell me, I have this pain and that pain, get lost. There is no support. There is no support. So naturally, what you will do? You will decide, Why all these unnecessary risks? Forget about it. And who knows what will be the outcome? Who knows what will be the product? Who knows what can be the side effect? That is the reason Buddha says the Sangha is equally important like a Buddha and Dhamma. See, Buddha can initiate you. Dhamma can inspire you. Only Sangha can bring Abhyasa to you. Please understand. Sometimes people ask me, Swamiji, in all spiritual organizations, so much of politics is there. Why are you creating one more organization? I tell them, it is necessary, devil. To create politics, you don't need two persons. One person is enough. See, morning your mind will be saying something, and night it will be saying something. It means what? Politics between you and you. So to do politics, you don't need two persons. One is enough. So it's a basic quality. Even if there is little politics, it is okay. Spiritual organization, Sangha, is worthy to have. Because Sangha creates so many times positive Abhyasa to you. Positive Abhyasa. Many times you can see, the moment you remember the people whom you meet in the bar, the moment you remember their smile, the moment you remember their dress, the moment you remember their body language, you are already in the car driving towards the bar. You don't even think and decide. Their very company gives you the courage. All your doctor's advice, no, your life will be reduced, risk of cancer, risk of this, risk of that. I know a guy who was drinking and smoking for 95 years and he was all right. You don't understand, he's an exemption, not a rule. He would have lived for 200 years. He's an exemption. But somehow, just two, three companies, you have all negative examples in front of you. And sometimes you don't even logically think that much. You are already there in the car and you are done. Sangha, a spiritual Sangha, can create positive Abhyasa. That is why these deities, the decoration, so much of jewels. The other day somebody was asking me, why do you put so much of silk and jewels? So much of decoration is done for the deities and even the seat in which you are sitting. The moment you remember all these things, you will be here. And positive Abhyasa can go on. Positive Abhyasa can happen. Many times, if you are depressed, feeling low, suddenly you remember the temple and all the people whom you meet are the deities. You are already in the car towards the temple. The positive Abhyasa can happen. That is why so much of energy, intelligence, time, money is put in the Sangha. All these things are put in the Sangha. People ask me, Swamiji, after all you are teaching Advaita, the ultimate enlightenment, why don't you keep your temple empty, formless? What will you be doing? You will be gazing at that empty wall. And in the bar, people want all the decoration to create negative Abhyasa, negative practice. In the temple, they want everything to be empty. What kind of mental setup? Understand what kind of mental setup. Negative Abhyasa. The whole civilization is based on negative Abhyasa. Buddha can initiate you into the truth. He can initiate you. He can give you the fire. He can just give you the experience. And Dhamma, The spiritual scriptures can constantly inspire you to live in that high state. Only Sangha can create the Abhyasa, coming back to that same state, establishing yourself into that same state again and again and again. Please understand, Abhyasa only makes you even as a man. Forget about spiritual man. Even integrity, you need Abhyasa. Without Abhyasa, you are just a liquid. Any thought can come, suddenly morning you will see, this is your joy, this is your pain, and you will start working towards it. By evening, some other thought, some other situation comes, all your idea about pain and joy disappears, you are entangled in something else. Just like the incident I was telling before when I began the discourse. See, when he came to walk with me, the big problem, he was heavily filled with that one idea that I am in so much love with her and she is not responding to me, she is not feeling connected to me, she is not loving me, she is not attending me. I can say this is the worst pain, big pain, the pain of rejection. That is the reason many of us start shrinking. Many of us start shrinking, the pain of rejection. Oh God, yes, I am really ready to open up. But if I am rejected, suddenly you lose respect for yourself. You lose respect for yourself. So he was in that pain. He was filled with that pain, filled with that idea. But in 10 minutes, his whole idea of suffering is different. Now his whole life energy is moving towards something else, about his house. And he is filled with the house. And in 1 hour, he is out of that problem. Now, logically, he is supposed to go towards the old problem. He is supposed to think about her, think about how to solve that problem. But it's not there. It means what? What you think as problem, sometime it comes, sometime it is not there. So your ideas about pain, love, problem, everything constantly is changing, constantly is moving, constantly disappearing, impermanent, not there. But one thing is there, your fear about whether this problem will come back or not, will come back or not, that constantly keeps you in suffering, constantly keeps you in suffering. I always tell people, this is just because of negative abhyasa. Never miss a chance to be around a Buddha, to be around a Sangha, to be around a Buddha, to be in the Sangha. Never miss a chance. I can say that is the ultimate thing can happen to you. So many negative abhyasas which you thought, which you may not even know inside you, will disappear. People come and tell me, Swamiji, I just came and stayed here for a few days and did volunteering. I don't know how my life is transformed. Nobody told me anything. Nobody spoke to me anything. Suddenly now I am out of many problems, many struggles, many disturbances. The same situation, if it has happened a few years earlier in my life, I would have been shaken. Now I am so strong. How come? How is it happening? Understand, the Sangha gives you positive abhyasa and it drills the abhyasa into your deeper layers. See, your conscious mind is one layer, your unconscious mind is 9 layer, below is your body, complete unconscious. Anything done continuously by the conscious gets inside your unconscious. Anything continuously repeated unconsciously gets inside your body, becomes physical habit. The word habit, you need to understand. H-A-B-I-T. If you remove H, a bit will be there. If you remove A, bit will be there. If you remove B, it will be there. Only when you remove the I, it will die. Understand? Only when you remove the I, it will die. Positive things also. Consciously, if you understand, and practice, it will go into unconscious. If you live around the people who have practiced, who are living this truth, suddenly you will see your bio memory will pick up the truth. Your bio memory will pick up the truth. You are not that intelligent to question every idea. First 2-3 ideas you may question. After a few days, suddenly you will pick up all the truths from them directly. That is why I tell people, in the initial level, even though you need to convince 1 or 2 people with 1 or 2 ideas, have patience. I always tell my ashramites, in the initial level, when people come, you may need to spend 10 minutes with them. You may need to tell them, no, relax, just be, feel comfortable, be here for 1 or 2 days. You may need to tell them 1 or 2 times, don't worry, take little time, tell. You will see, surely they will thank you after a few days just for your request. Because these great truths, you see, this is the place where constantly truth is spoken, truth is lived, truth is radiating in various ways. Again and again and again, these ideas are, again and again, these ideas will resonate in your being. Even if you don't want, you have to listen. Somebody will be sitting and talking about 7th chakra. Somebody will be sitting and talking about yoga. Somebody will be sitting and talking about some miracle, some incidents they had with Swamiji. Sometimes even if you feel, oh God, what is this? Everybody is telling so many stories, it looks too much. But in few days you will see the tremendous transformation, the positive abhyasa happening inside you. Ramakrishna says very beautifully, if you drank 1 liter country liquor, at least 1/4 liter, the rice water you need to drink to get out of that addiction or to get out of that sober mood. Same way, if you have spent few days with the negative abhyasa, at least spend few hours in positive abhyasa. The sangha, importance of sangha, that is why Buddha says, I have created this sangha so that this truth will be kept alive continuously and transmitted to next generation. Many people come and tell me, Swamiji, you just tell me what meditation I should do, I'll do it in the house. I tell them, you will never start. You will never start. Attend a meditation workshop. In the whole group, you are forced to do. Naturally, what I'll say, tie your eyes, close your eyes, tie the ribbon. You can't do anything. You may be feeling lazy, but you can't do anything. I've seen these fitness instructors. They don't care. They don't even look at your face that you are expressing your tiredness. No, this hand is paining, that hand is paining. They don't look at you. They just say, do 1, 2, 3, 30 seconds. Right attitude. You are here saying, no. They don't bother. They just turn their face that side. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Only in the end they look at you and ask, are you all right? Here you are crying, you are asking this in the end. Same thing I also do. Only in the end I'll ask, did you enjoy? The whole day I know, because I have to create the positive abhyasa. Never miss a chance to live in the sangha. Understand, abhyasa means creating positive habits, positive things inside you so that it can go from conscious to unconscious, from unconscious to your body. Making all the good things as part of your life is what I call abhyasaha. Patanjali very beautifully says, I just wanted to repeat that word. Tatra sthitau yatnobhyasaha. The effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness is abhyasaha. Understand, many time when you listen all these words, you get completely inspired. I have decided from tomorrow, I am not going to miss Nitya Dhyan. And you buy Nitya Dhyan CD, DVD, ACD, audio CD, book. Sometime I have seen husband will buy one set and wife will buy one set. Wife will say, no, if you are reading that book, in that page, I don't want to interfere you. I want my own set. And all kinds of things. And everything is ready, except you. Except you. In the initial level, you need to go to a spiritual place. I can say this is a positive pub, where you see the body language of the people who drink divine, who drank the divine, who are enjoying, who are radiating it, who are dancing with it, who are living it. You need to see their body language. You yourself need to be in that space. You need to be encouraged. You need that positive abhyasa. He says, effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness. The big problem is, your body is unconscious. It has learned many habits earlier for so many years. So when you suddenly experience some higher truths, one glimpse, one strong experience, but your brain grooves are not habituated to hold on to that experience or to hold on to that high state of consciousness. The brain grooves are created only in a usual unconscious way. So what happens? You come down. Even I came down. When I had my enlightenment at the age of 12, it did not stay with me. I was not in that same state. In the 3 days, it disappeared. It was such a big missing. Unimaginable missing. Understand? Unimaginable missing. Till yesterday, you know you are God. And suddenly now, you are back. How it will be? See, if you don't know you are God, you are a consciousness, you are an enlightened soul, you know at least this is what you just put up with it, live with it, okay. But you know it, and suddenly your body is not ready to live that. That is the worst missing can happen. When I went back, I was pouring. Because it was like a 2.5 days bliss fever. 2.5 days bliss fever. At the age of 12, I had that strong experience, feeling everything is me. Understand, you feeling that you are alive inside one body gives you so much of joy. I started feeling I am alive in everything. The tree, in the plant, in the stones, in the hill, in the temple, everything, in the air, in the sky. How strongly you feel you are alive inside this skin, your skin. I started feeling with that same strength, I am alive inside this pillow, inside this seat, everything. It was such a joy, ecstasy, liberation. No fear, nothing to lose. Nothing to gain, nothing to lose. That is why there is nobody who is my favorite. Because I am just inside that body. Just I am inside this body, I am inside that body. There is no favorite. Just before coming to USA, one of my new brahmachari, new guy who came to the ashram, I was giving little attention to him and teaching him. And every day I'll just at least spend 10 minutes with him asking, how are you feeling comfortable, you are settled and all those things. When I was coming to the USA, he asked me, Swamiji, will you forget me? I just laughed and said, I never remembered you. Relax about forgetting. There is no favorite. There is no favorite. If I am giving attention to somebody, if I am standing and talking, at the most, the possibility for the spiritual growth is there, that's all. The possibility for the spiritual explosion is there. Sometimes people are stuck in some places, you see. They will have very strong spiritual pull. They will not even know it's a spiritual pull. Just suddenly they know. Inside the heart, just they keep myself and enjoy. And inside the heart, when they remember me, there's a twinkle in the eyes. When they see, there's a twinkle in the eyes, the corner of the eyes. Just it is such a pleasant feeling. I am there, inside. Maybe in the waking state, or in the dream state, or in the deep sleep state, I am there. Same way, the other part of the mind, the negative abhyasa, it will create all kinds of fear and questions and apprehensions. Either judging about me, or the community around, or some situation. See, the negative abhyasa is so powerful, it can show anything into negative. It can show anything into negative. I have seen people suffering with that negative abhyasa, negative conditioning. And that negative conditioning is such, it can create any problem out of any problem. And just simple thing, I have seen people, when somebody comes, if you give attention and tell them, how are you doing? Well, please have food and rest. Then they think, no, I'm not doing anything, how can I be here? Then if you tell them, don't do this work, do that work, no, they are taking too much work out of me. Maybe for the work reason only they are asking me to be here. Mind can play any game. The negative abhyasa. One side, the beautiful feeling connection is also there. The other side, the negative abhyasa, the negative apprehensions, that is also there. That's creating some questions, some constant, you see, negative abhyasa will constantly make you think. What is this? What is that? What is this? What is that? What is this? What is that? Constantly think. Sometime when people are stuck in that level, that place, I just, out of compassion, I give them little attention. How do you feel? Are you okay? Because little attention, they can just come out of that negative apprehension, negative abhyasa. It can be broken. The master's love is such a amazing energy. Nothing needs to be done. One smile. One word. Are you comfortable? Are you settled? That's enough. It can just work inside. The negative abhyasa will just lose its power over you. I have seen. That is the only purpose or only reason. Sometime rarely I give attention. Otherwise there is no. Because I know completely I am feeling everything. Fight between the negative abhyasa and that feeling connection you feel with the master is the worst thing. I can say in a way it is the best thing, because you have to go through. Sometime the negative abhyasa wins and they escape. What to do? Maybe a few years will be wasted, or sometime even few lives will be wasted. When they come again, after a few years, after a few life, either I may not be there, or they may not be in the situation to be around me, or I may be there, they may be there, the click may not happen, or both may be there, click may happen, but the place may not be proper. So many things. So I always tell people, don't miss. I have seen people missing in the initial level many times. Just they will say, simple reason. No, I don't have hot water here. I can't stay. In the ashram, I have seen. The Bidhi ashram, just because they don't have hot water, they will say, no, after you by 1 year, you will have hot water and all the facilities. We will come back and stay at that time. They will go. It will never happen again. Over. Just because there is no hot water, they escape. They are in the hell, what to do? Nothing can be done. The negative abhyasa is so powerful. It is such a strong thing. Any positive glimpse, it will shake. Let me give you an experience about my own negative abhyasa. I think that will give you a opening. When I had this enlightenment experience, it completely shook me. All my ideas about enlightenment disappeared. Just like when you meet me, all your ideas about enlightened master will disappear. I'll be mind-boggling. You can't comprehend. If you are fortunate, if you just see me in a class and go away. No, really. You spend little time around me, all your ideas about enlightened master will disappear. So alive, so spontaneous, unimaginable, unable to put inside your frame, you will feel shaken. All my ideas about enlightenment disappear. And I was there in that field, filled. Maybe it took 2.5 years, 2.5 hours, sorry, 2.5 days. It is neither 2.5 hours nor 2.5 years. It looked like 2.5 hours or 2.5 years. It's chronologically 2.5 days. When I started settling, first thing happened to me, I thought some ghost has possessed me. Because I never knew about enlightenment, that enlightenment will be like this. Some ghost, because the negative abhyasa starts taking over. Negative abhyasa is taking over. The mental groove is not able to hold that experience. So negative abhyasa is taking over. The other side, my mind started telling, don't go to that place again. I started thinking that place, there is some ghost. Because I went and sat there, that ghost got hold of me. And I should never go to that place again. And that is the way I am supposed to go to my school every day. I'll never go that way. After that, it took 6 months to go near that place for me. Started the negative abhyasa taking over. Not only that, I started feeling all kinds of things. I think there was one Swami who was teaching me yoga and another one Swami was teaching Vedanta. I thought, who knows what these guys are teaching me and where I am landing, what will happen to me. All kinds of apprehension, all kinds of fear. And it is not standing, staying. When I went back and asked that Mataji, when Mataji was there, she was teaching me little Tantra and Vedanta. I asked her, this is what happened? Am I possessed by ghost? She laughed and said, you are possessed by God. And she told me, just be around me for a few days, nothing else. And she said, I'll cook and give you the food. Eat and be around me. I asked, how can that help? You just be there, nothing else. But just eating that food and being around her, suddenly I saw my body is picking up the courage to leave that enlightenment. My brain is creating new grooves to leave that enlightenment. My system is falling in tune to leave that enlightenment, to leave that joy, to radiate that joy. I suddenly started feeling, I have a company. I have company. There are many people who lived what I am living, who went through what I am going through. You feel comfortable. You are not alone. That statement can be given only by Sangha, never by, even not even by Buddha. Please understand. Even I cannot give you that courage. Only Sangha can give you that courage. If I say, then you will say, no, 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 you are enlightened. You are in a different plane. Don't compare you and us. You have all kinds of ideas. No. Sangha can give you that courage. Sangha can give you that confidence. Sangha can create that new brain grooves where positive abhyasa can happen. You can be again and again and again in that elevated consciousness, joy, ecstasy, bliss. You can raise yourself, not only for spiritual enlightenment, even to live an integrated, happy life, you need abhyasa. You need abhyasa. Even to live a happy life, I am not talking about enlightened life, even to live a happy life, you need abhyasa. Because constantly, so many cyclones are happening inside you. Actually, just like a CNN weather channel, you need an internal weather channel. Today, there may be 3 tornado, 2 tsunami, 10 earthquake. That is what is happening inside. Look, how many tsunamis, how many earthquakes, how many Katrinas, how many tornadoes happening constantly. You need positive abhyasa to handle even this weather, even these tornadoes. Positive abhyasa is a safe shelter where you are neither touched nor affected by these tornadoes, by these tsunamis, by these earthquakes, by these floods, by these disturbances, by these difficulties. You need to know the abhyasa is the ultimate shelter and resort you can create for yourself. The positive abhyasa is the ultimate shelter, ultimate resort you can create for yourself. That's the ultimate truth can happen to you. Please understand. When I went back to the master, all he said, I asked him, first thing I had the fear. I thought I was possessed by a ghost. This Mataji, she told me, no, you are not possessed by a ghost, you are possessed by God. And she gave me the courage after a few days. That fear went away. What happened to me was wrong. That fear went away. Now the greed started. Oh God, it went away. How can I have it back? I rushed to this one great Swami, Annamalai Swami. He is an enlightened disciple of Raman Maharshi. He told me only one word. This sutra. Essence of this sutra. Abhyasa. Bring yourself back to that same mood, same space, again and again and again. Let your body be soaked. Let your body be processed by that consciousness. He told me, let it be cooked by that consciousness. Bring yourself back again and again and again to that same state, either by studying or by listening or by remembering or by meditating, whatever it takes. Sometimes remembering will work. Suddenly, nothing need to be done. Just the photograph of the master is enough. You are in tears. You don't know why. You are just completely relaxed. You are in ecstasy. Sometime, talking to brother disciple, talking to somebody who had the experience, who is in the Sangha, who is experienced or a little more senior, sometime reading the books, sometime listening to the words, or using all, any one or more than one or all. Use any of this and raise yourself again and again and again to that same state. Please understand. After that enlightenment, I did not need, he told me very clearly, you don't need any other practice. All you need is just this abhyasaha. All you need, bring yourself back again and again. You will fall. You will slip. It's okay. Come back again. You fall. Come back again. Let you not be tired of falling. If you are tired of falling, then negative abhyasa has won over you. Negative practice has won. If you are not tired of falling, then positive practice is one winning. So either you will become tired of falling, means your negativity has won over you. Or you will have the courage to stand up. Your positive energy has won over you. That's all. There is no other compromising. People come and ask me, please give us some technique. There is no technique. Only intensity. All technique means what? Indirectly, I will be telling the same thing, abhyasa. Now, people come and ask me, how to keep the intensity, Swamiji? Give us some technique. If I give them some technique, Swamiji, how to do this technique? Please give us some intensity. Then I have to give some more technique. Then they say, no, 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 Swamiji, please teach us how to do the technique properly. Give us some technique. Understand, intensity and abhyasa is the one and only technique. All other techniques are different versions of this abhyasa word. That's all. Many times, when people ask me the questions, see, any answer will create only more questions. So I never answer them. I just divert their attention. They feel, oh, see, intelligent answer Swamiji gave. Only I know, I just diverted them from the question. That's all. People ask me, Swamiji, what is ori? I tell them, constant inner chattering. What is inner chattering? I tell them, ori. They think they have the answer now. Nothing but adding few more words to their question. They feel they are attended. That's all. And honestly, nobody is bothered about a question answer and all. They want to know that when they put a question, two reasons. One, they want to tell you that they know something. Or they want your attention. Or they want to check whether you know or not. And when you attend them, things are over. That's all. The other day, one guy came to me and asked, Swamiji, I want to achieve God. Give me some technique. I told him, I did not answer directly. I asked him, you are from where? How many kids you have? What is your profession? After that, 4 hours he was with me, chatting, talking, so many things. He did not even remember once this question again, second time. No, he did not remember. Means understand the intensity of the question. Many times, our questions are like this only. Many times, our questions are like this only. All the answers, all the techniques are different versions of this one truth, abhyasaha. What makes you to get established in the higher state of consciousness and that conflict-free mood, joy and ecstasy? Do that again and again. Come back to that state of consciousness through all possible ways and methods again and again and again. That's all is essence of abhyasa. Here, the Patanjali says, tatra stitau yadno abhyasaha. The effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness is abhyasa. Again and again and again, elevate yourself. Elevate yourself. Raise yourself. Bring yourself back to that center. Many times you can see, when you read a spiritual literature, very strong books, you feel, I should leave this. I have decided. The elevated mood, the strength, courage. When you listen to this kind of discourses, at least next 2 days, I should leave. I should leave. That strength. Again and again, bring yourself back to that strength by doing the actions which brings you, which helps you to come back to this state. If listening to the discourses does that job, do it. If reading the books does that job, do it. Mixing with the Sangha does that job? Do it. Or meditating does that job? Do it. That is what Patanjali calls abhyasaha. Till it gets drilled inside your body, till all the negative abhyasas are broken, let it be drilled inside your body. As I was telling yesterday, if you are seeing the world, you are not seeing the God. If you are seeing the God, you are not seeing the world. As long as you see the world which creates fear and greed inside you, you need abhyasa. Come back. Come back. Come back. Unclutch. 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 Again and again and again and again. Till you can't unclutch. Unclutch. There will be one point, the unclutcher will disappear in unclutching. Till then, unclutch. Unclutcher will disappear into unclutching. Till then, unclutch. That is the only way. That is the only truth. Nothing else. There is no other word. There is no compromising. This is the truth. This is the way. This is the life. Whatever makes you to live in that elevated state of consciousness, come back. Get back to that by doing it. Live that. Radiate that. There is no other way. There is no other solution. There is no other life. You may feel that I am repeating the same truth again and again and again, because truth has to be repeated till you listen. It is challenge between you and me. No, not even you and me. Your unconsciousness and me. It is not fight between your conscious and me. It is fight between your unconscious and me. Your conscious actually wants to be around me. It feels connected. But unconscious, that negative abhyasa creates all apprehensions. Now I have to play with the negative apprehension. Sometime I should look, I should behave as if I am not caring for you. Sometime I should behave, I am attending you. Because the problem is, if I attend you, you may think, I think this guy has some ulterior motive. He is trying to make me Swami, Sannyasi. Or he is trying to do something out of me. If I don't give attention, this fellow behaves too big. He doesn't give attention to me. What to do? He's a big guy. And too many people are there around him like me. I am only one among his disciples. Something. The negative abhyasa goes on playing with me. It's a big game between you and my negative, me and your negative abhyasa. Till it gets drilled into your body, I have to play this game. I have to play this game. The idea, the spiritual seeking, the spiritual intensity, living conflict-free life, living as Jivan Mukta, till this idea gets into your body. It gets into your body means, if you don't eat, how you feel hungry. Same way, if you move out of that Jivan Mukti state, living enlightenment state, your body will feel, come back. It should become that physical. Till then, you need abhyasa. Till then, I'll continue to be with you. I have to be continue to be with you. Playing the game through my presence or my absence. Through my presence or my absence. Sometimes people come and ask me, Swamiji, bless me that you will not leave me even if I leave you. No, all kinds of things they ask me. No, really. Understand, at some time you would have prayed like that. Sometime, even if people wanted to go, I send message, maybe directly or indirectly. Have little patience, try to be around. It will do many good things inside you. Means that person would have prayed at some part of the life, maybe in this Janma or some earlier Janma, that even if I wanted to leave you, please don't leave me. Hold on to me. That intensity, that prayer is what I answer when I extend my hand. When I tell them, relax, be around the Sangha. It will do big job inside you. It will do big job. It will just, I can say, it's a conscious cyclone. Whatever you think as a big problem, it will all just disappear. You will see you are fresh, alive. Your whole life is new in front of you. You have the guts, courage, energy, completely fresh being to live. You are ready for a Jivan Mukta life. This state, it should be it should get inside your unconscious and it should become part of your very body. Till then, you need abhyasa. Till then, you need abhyasa. Abhyasa means again and again and again. Bring yourself to that unclutching state. Unclutch and be in that Jivan Mukti state. If you have fallen, again unclutch, be in that Jivan Mukti state. I always tell people this bangle, this, all these things are just for this abhyasa only, this mala, bangle, all these things are for abhyasa only. So that constantly you are reminded, whenever you see the bangle, whenever you see that cup, you will be reminded, come back, understand, this is for abhyasa, this is for abhyasa. If you are wearing that mala, remember, this body is supposed to live Jivan Mukti. If you are wearing that bracelet, remember, constantly you have to come back to that unclutched state. If you are wearing that bracelet with Nityanandam, means you have taken a vow, you will live in Nityananda, eternal bliss. It's not for fashion, one more ornament. No, really. In India, I became a household name. So wearing this bracelet and mala has become fashion. That's a big problem. No, it became fashion sometime. Earlier, nobody was wearing because everybody will ask, what is this? You became Swami? You are running behind Nityananda Swami now? What happened to you? Now running behind me is a prestige. Earlier, the game was on the other side. Now the critical mass has gathered. So what to do? Now running behind me is a prestige. Now everybody starts wearing because of prestige. Earlier people were caught in fear, now they are caught in greed. Don't wear because of greed or fear. Wear with understanding. Then it is useful. Then it is useful. Constantly reminding you. All these things will constantly remind you to be in abhyasa. To be in abhyasa. Understand? Abhyasa is the practice. Abhyasa is the truth you need to carry even after enlightenment. Even after enlightenment. Because after enlightenment, abhyasa will be your breathing. Your very inhaling and exhaling will be abhyasa. But it will be abhyasa. It will be practice. It will be practice. After enlightenment, you don't need to do. The abhyasa will happen by itself. Till abhyasa happens by itself, do it. Do it till it happens. I have taken too much time to explain this one concept. Then understand the importance of this one truth. The importance of this one truth. Whatever may be your problem, this is the one solution, master key, abhyasaha, tatra sthitau, yatnobhyasaha, the effort to remain constantly in that elevated state of awareness is abhyasa. So, be in that intelligence, be in that awareness. See, many times, when you slip out of that awareness, you don't even know what you are doing. You are completely confused. You are completely confused. You don't know what you are doing. So come back to that abhyasa center. Otherwise, you just create chaos and you don't even know that you are creating chaos. One story for you. It's a news about an accident. Alabama's worst air disaster occurred early this morning when a small two-seater Cessna plane crashed into a cemetery. Search and rescue workers have recovered 1,826 bodies so far and expect that number to climb as digging continues. Understand? The accident and the result, no way connected. When you don't know how to come back to your center, the accident happening inside you, the result of that accident will no way be connected. You'll be just creating chaos. See, your life is nothing but chaos. Sometime I sincerely feel the whole world is running based on madness. Please understand, I am not talking philosophy. I very sincerely feel, what for it is happening? We are not awakened to the truth of your existence and the truth of existence of the world and the truth of connection between your existence and the existence of the world. You are not awakened to these three truths. What for you exist, what for this cosmos exists, and what is the connection between your existence and the cosmos existence. Please understand. If you understand these three things, suddenly you will be aligned. And cosmos will express its truth through you. Cosmos will live through you. People ask me many times, how did you create such a big sangha, such a big organization, all in 6 years? I tell them, I did not create. I just got awakened to my existence and cosmos existence and the connection between these two existence. And what cosmos wants to do is doing through me, that's all. It is happening through this body because I am awakened to the truth of my existence and cosmos existence and the connection between these two existence. Just it is happening. Till you are awakened to these three truths, whatever you may be doing is nothing but grabbing in the darkness. Just moving in the darkness. Don't get depressed. Don't think, oh, that is not for me. I think it is not for me. This Swami is putting big ideals. No. It is for you now. That is what I call abhyasa. Bring yourself back again and again. I went through what you are going through. So I know I am not just encouraging you. Please understand, I am telling you the truth. In the village, when you walk through the forest, if you ask some villager how many kilometers to cross the forest, always all the villagers will tell, no, you almost crossed, you almost crossed. The trekking in the Grand Canyon. You are almost there, you are almost there. No, I am not talking in that language, understand? I don't bother. Whether you crash or not, who cares? I don't have to bother. All I bother is whether I am talking the honest truth or not. Understand? I am telling you the truth. I am not encouraging you. I am not just telling you some idea to encourage you. No, I am telling you the truth. I went through the same situation which you are going through. Paramahamsa means a man who has went through all possible situations. Only then he can teach. I went through everything. So I can tell you, understand, the abhyasa is a basic need and simple need and nothing else is required. You don't even have to think how long I should do abhyasa. Relax from all those ideas. Do abhyasa now. You will see. You are in the truth now. You are in the truth now. And if you slip, if you feel you have slipped, then again come back to the abhyasa. Be in the truth now. The more time you come back to the truth, your negative abhyasa loses its power. Your negative bio-memory loses its power. You are awakened. Your strong positive abhyasa explodes inside you and you start residing in that same state. You start living in that experience. That is what I call Jivan Mukti. That is what I call Jivan Mukti. What happened to me when I was 12 is enlightenment. I needed little positive abhyasa to remove the negative abhyasa. People ask me, you are an incarnation, how can negative abhyasa happen? Please understand, out of pure gold you can't make jewels, so you need to add little copper, make jewel, and you should again put it in the acid and take away that copper and make it as a pure gold again. Now you have a jewelry which is pure gold. Same way, out of pure consciousness you can't create a body. So little negative abhyasa means tamas and rajas, out of pure sattva you can't create body. So little tamas and rajas is added and body is created. After the body is created, then again start burning, put in the acid, do tapas, burn it, burn that negative abhyasa. Now you have a body which is pure consciousness, like jewel which is pure 24 karat gold. Same way you have a body which is pure consciousness. Abhyasa is a basic thing. Try again and again and again. Come back. After some time you will see, you will forget the moments when you are not in abhyasa. You will remember only the moments when you are in abhyasa. The big enemy for abhyasa is guilt, self-condemnation. Don't allow that. If you miss, if you slip 3-4 times, you will say, no. How can I am slipping again and again. Instead of using the word, I am slipping again and again, remember, I will unclutch again and again. I will stand again and again. The same time it takes, many times I have seen, same energy it takes to feel guilty, repent, how much time and energy you take, that same time only you need to unclutch and come back to the higher state. Because you have the negative abhyasa, you create guilt. Now break, come back to that higher state instead of creating guilt. Let it become positive abhyasa. Let you be centered and positive abhyasa. Instead of creating guilt, you will create enlightenment. What do you want to do in the life? Whether guilt or enlightenment. If you waste your energy by saying, I am slipping, you will create guilt. If you bring yourself back again and again to the center, you will create enlightenment. So, I bless you all. Let you all achieve and radiate this great truth, abhyasa, in your life and live enlightenment. Let you all achieve and radiate the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.